The sixth mass extinction on Earth has officially begun and could threaten humanity's existence. Wow. No, that is not something I read on a piece of cardboard from a guy on the street corner. That is one of the headlines that appeared around the world last week when Paul Ehrlich of Stanford University released his new study that says the clock isn't just ticking. Time might have already run out. Tonight on What in the World, Sirius XM, Channel 167, Canada Talks. Our guest today is Dr. Paul Ehrlich, who's been somebody you probably have heard of over the years, awarded many prizes throughout his esteemed career as an American ecologist, talking a lot about population growth and ultimately the evolution of this species on this earth, the coexistence of this species with the rest of the planet and where we're going as a society. Recently, a study was published that caught the attention not just of the rest of the scientific community, but pretty much every major media outlet in the world. And in the era that we're living in, that got shared at an exponential rate throughout social media and got lots of people's attention, especially when the headline to that study was something that included words like the sixth mass extinction event on Earth has officially begun. Dr. Paul Ehrlich joins us today on What in the World. How are you, Dr. Ehrlich?
I'm sitting in a mountain cabin at 9,600 feet, enjoying a beautiful view of mountains, aspens, and so on. It's where my field work.
So you are exactly where I'd like to be right now, but I'm in a cramped studio here in Toronto, Canada, but equally interested in this, not just the article that I read a few weeks ago that obviously spawned the research for today's piece, but what I was more interested in was the reaction. I think there's a real sort of gap between really important work at the academic level and really a reaction or a resonance at the mainstream media level. Often I find really incredibly important stuff, like, you know, as the 10th story on CNN's website after, you know, a couple of celebrity stories or whatever. But this particular study really got the attention of the world. What's been the reaction and why do you think it really managed to resonate this time?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question that I too am interested in because I'm a part-time propagandist. This is nothing brand new. It's a confirmation of what the scientific community has been saying actually since about 1980 in some detail. But it's kind of like climate change in that it's something that doesn't strike people very much in their personal lives. If a certain bird doesn't appear in your garden for a couple of years, that's too bad, but you hardly notice it. It's like the climate change situation. Both climate change and the loss of biodiversity are, first of all, very tightly connected with each other, and both of them threaten the existence of our civilization, yet it's slow motion, and what does it do for me today? And, of course, climate change is opposed by a very well-funded group of deniers. An entire TV network in the United States is dedicated to fooling people about climate change. Biodiversity hasn't hit the front lines as much as climate change, but now it has, and that's a good thing. The exact reasons, I can only guess.
It's interesting because I saw that, and I'm actually trying to Google the name of the documentary that I saw about a month ago that was about those spin doctors that you're referring to, specific to the climate change debate and how they managed to sort of reshape it over the last, let's say, 5 years. 7 years from the apex, which would have been around the Inconvenient Truth Al Gore era, and then subsequently
Merchants of Doubt.
Yes, bingo. Sorry, what's that again?
The book was named The Merchants of Doubt by Naomi Oreskes, who's the best historian in the world today, and a wonderful documentary was made out of it. It's a book worth everybody reading if you have any interest in your children, grandchildren, or your own future. But it shows how the same people who tried to fool you about smoking and their lineal descendants are now trying to fool you about climate disruption.
So I want to talk about that a lot, actually, today. As much as we're going to talk about the study and all the very important data that came out of that, which we'll certainly cite. But I'm just beyond fascinated by what you just touched on. And somebody who spent as long as you have studying demographics, studying society, studying human behavior, I'm very curious whether anything from your esteemed career as an academic, as somebody that's been at the forefront of many issues, can even come close to answering the question, which is, what is it that, like, you touched on how we don't really react until there's literally a fire, you know, under our ass, so to speak, right? I mean, we as a society, individually and collectively, seem to need crisis. But beyond that, when you mention these people who come out and do everything they can to fight against you know, climate change, et cetera, and all these other things, I would think that the strongest instinct for a human being, and it seems to be the case with every other species, is their survival instinct. Yet, how is that survival instinct able to be trumped so effectively when literally you have people sort of, you know, Nero-like playing the violin while Rome is burning, yet still able to delude themselves into believing somehow that they could somehow survive without a planet? Like, do you understand what I'm saying?
Oh, I know, and it's something that's interested me for a long time. I've had a life of failure. I've had failure to convince people of what I think the reason is for what you just mentioned. And that is, we are the products of a very long period of evolution, billions of years, a couple of 100,000 years as modern Homo sapiens. And yet for almost that entire period, what we were selected for was being able to react to immediate threats. That is, if somebody throws a baseball at your head, you don't have to do any conferring or thinking or anything else. You do a series of very complicated differential equations, and you duck. And you know how to do that. Even more important for virtually our entire history, our evolutionary trend has been to hold the background constant, because the threats are things moving or changing in against that background. It's the leopard creeping up on you that you want to spot. If you've ever birdwatched, you know it's a hell of a lot easier to birdwatch when there's no wind, because if the background, if the trees are all moving, you can't really spot the motions that are the birds. Hmm. So we have adapted ourselves to keep the background steady, even if it isn't steady. Hmm. And so you will hear people, for instance, I went to Australia first in 1965. They were having a drought. And one of the newspaper headlines said, this is a 100-year drought. It only occurs about every 100 years. The last time was 1955. Everybody thinks the world's going to remain stationary because that's what we evolved to think. But the problem today is the changes are in the backdrop. We've gotten rid of the leopards, but we're changing the temperature of the entire planet. That's part of the backdrop, but we do not perceive the change easily. And that's the same thing with the loss of biodiversity. It's the same thing with toxic substances now occupying the entire planet from pole to pole. Scientists can spot the effects. Scientists know they can end our civilization. Scientists can tell people about this. But when somebody gets up and says, you know, we really don't understand, the scientific community can't prove it's going to happen, which is true, by the way. Science never proves anything. Then they find it easy to ignore, particularly when the ignoring allows you to continue, for those of us who are in the rich countries, to live a pretty decent lifestyle and enjoy ourselves. Mm.
You're familiar with the frog in the boiling water analogy?
Indeed, I'm sitting in it right now.
Well, but it's so interesting.
I'm too old to leap out.
Yeah, how true it is that obviously, you know, and for the people that aren't familiar with that that phrase, it's that you can throw a frog into a pot of boiling water and it will jump out. But if you put a frog in a pot of water and incrementally turn up the heat until it's boiling, it will stay there and die. And that certainly feels like something that's applicable here. And you mentioned merchants of doubt, and you know, I think you somewhat facetiously said, I've been failing for, you know, what is that, 40 or 50 years, but you've done a yeoman's work to try to be able to sort of sound the alarms. One of the things that I took away from Merchants of Doubt that was really interesting to me, and part of the, I think part of the overall premise, but I don't know if there's been anything done to really address the issue, which is you had really prominent academics and scientists who had basically said, we lost this war because we underestimated the importance of communications. And what we're finding in the world that we're living in, especially now, you're a very articulate person. You can come on a show and express not only the data, but I think even the emotion of something like this. What is it about the gap between, let's say, scientists and the ability to articulate something that can actually connect and resonate with the masses? And is there a way to prioritize that enough that the war can be won?
Well, we've been trying to prioritize it in the scientific community, particularly in the ecological community, for some time. There's been a whole program, for example, trying to train ecologists to communicate the problems we're facing to the general public, because certainly in my generation, the idea was that scientists did not talk a lot about what society ought to do about their findings, but ought to publish their findings and let it go at that. And that, of course, has changed totally. The medical community, for instance, now feels perfectly free to tell you that smoking's going to kill you. And what we need to do is convert that sort of thing in areas like environmental science, so scientists feel perfectly free to get out there and say, as we teach our students now, you say, first of all, what the consensus is on a problem. That is, what the scientific community as a whole thinks about it. Then you say, what my own research indicates. If you have findings that don't fit in with those of the scientific consensus, you publish them, and people will argue with you about them. And that's one of the things that scientists do. So you can then give your view as a scientist of the problem. And then the last step is you should give your view of what you think society should be doing about the problem. Why should you deny the people who have spent their lives, say, looking at climate change? Scientists, thousands of scientists who have spent years and years and years each studying the climate system, which is a hell of a difficult system. And they think something like, A, what we're doing now is threatening civilization, and some moron like Senator Imhoff gets up and says, I think it's a hoax. Now, why should the media give his view the same weight as the view of 2,000 people who have studied it honestly and desperately, arguing with each other over it on many points and so on? Why should his view be given at equal weight to those of the scientific community? And the answer is, of course, obviously they shouldn't.
Yeah, and that's, the biggest victim of the world we live in media-wise today is certainly context, and that's really where the gap is when you're talking about complex issues. You can't do it in a minute and a half soundbite. We're going to continue on the other side of the break with Dr. Paul Ehrlich, get a little more into the study and some of the numbers that will really jump out at you, and I think hopefully capture people's attention around the urgency of the issues that we're dealing with today. It is What in the World, SiriusXM Canada Talks, Channel 167.
Worn out faces, bright and early for the daily races, going nowhere, going nowhere.
Sometimes I'm right.
This is What in the World on Canada Talks, SiriusXM 167.
And welcome back to the show. We are with Dr. Paul Ehrlich of Stanford University. The study that really caught the attention of the world recently, again, talking about a sixth mass extinction event. There's obviously some context here to get into. First of all, what were the first five? And then, I guess, what are the red flags? What are the canaries in the coal mine for you and your co-researchers on this particular work? And I guess the main difference here being that those other extinction events were not caused by us.
A main distinction. Yeah. The biggest ones... The biggest one was at the end of the Permian. If you had geology in college, the intersections between the big periods that were named, things like Permian and Triassic and so on and so forth, often were signs of mass extinction events or large extinction events, because certain things disappeared from the fossil record, and other things came in, and so they changed the name. And the one that's most famous and most recent is the one at the so-called KT Brown boundary, 65 million years ago, when all the dinosaurs except the birds bit the dust. And as most people know, that probably was caused by an extraterrestrial body colliding with Earth and wiping out almost everything. Now, human beings didn't cause that. But it's also important to remember there were no human beings to suffer the consequences. There were very few mammals. In fact, it wasn't until the dinosaurs were wiped out that the mammals got a chance to diversify and eventually evolve into us. If it weren't for that, you'd have a velociraptor probably on the other end of the phone. we're trying to run a overpopulated, overconsuming, suffering civilization of 7.3 billion people and causing a catastrophic loss of the parts of our life support systems. It's not a very clever way to go. The scientific community has realized this for some time, at least formally for 30, 40, 50 years. The first important books on extinction came out around 1980, but the problem has been known for a lot longer than that. What happened in our study is people have argued, April, how do you discover if you're starting into a mass extinction event? What you're going to see, April, extinction is going on all the time as part of the course of evolution. New organisms are evolving, old organisms are going extinct. So a mass extinction event is where suddenly the rate of extinction of old organisms becomes extremely high, way out of balance with the rate at which new organisms are evolving. And so the issue today has been exactly what are the rates. They're very difficult to come to because you've got the fossil record in which you can try and figure out what the extinction rates were between the mass extinctions. What's the background rate? What was sort of going on all the time with nothing special going on? That's the background rate. And then how much faster were the extinctions in the mass extinction? Well, we know, for example, that the KT extinction, the one 65 million years ago, was almost instantaneous. When you have extraterrestrial body hit the planet, one of the earlier extinctions was caused by increasing volcanism, and may well have taken millions of years, which is a short time in the history of life. The one we're going into now is probably in between those two. It's not instantaneous, but we do have records of what things have been going extinct in modern times. And what our study did was take a very conservative estimate of how fast the background rate was. In other words, if the background rate was very fast, and we see a very fast rate today, that doesn't indicate we're going into a mass extinction. But what we found was, even assuming a twice as rapid background rate as most other scientific studies have assumed, and we took a very special new study from the fossil record of mammals, and then took a very conservative estimate of the rate today, only counting things as extinct if we absolutely knew they were extinct. There are many, many things we believe are extinct, but of course there are only so many biologists, there are only so many things you can census, so you don't know whether they're really all gone or not. So we took a very conservative estimate of the rate today, slow conservative estimate today, fast conservative estimate for the past, and it turns out even there, today we're probably on the order, according to this set of data, of maybe 100 to more times more rapid extinction rate than the background. Other estimates are thousands of times more, but the point is there's no question at all, even if it's 10 times more, that indicates we're going into a mass extinction event. And of course, we know perfectly well how human beings are causing it. There's no mystery at all there.
Well, let's read some of the sort of headlines that were focused on coming out of the study. You know, you just touched on that species are disappearing at about 100 times faster than normal rate. And, you know, that's something that you're almost seeing every day again in terms of, wow, you know, you find out this particular species is, you know, is not just on the brink of extinction. It's literally, you know, it's actually happening. Experts warn that it could take the Earth millions of years to recover, which is also an interesting wrinkle, and we can expand on that a bit. They say humanity would likely disappear early on in the process, which that might get our attention, and if it doesn't, well, that's perhaps maybe one of the problems we should be focusing on. And then previous extinctions, as we touched on, were caused by natural disasters, and obviously there's a lot of things that are man-made. This is what I'd like to bring up, and I hate the term devil's advocate, so I won't use it, but what I will say is this. I do have friends that certainly believe that numbers are overblown, that there isn't absolute evidence that things are caused or that are man-made or caused by that climate change is caused by humans, etc. That, you know, that there's warming in other planets in our solar system, so this could all be related to the sun, etc. Let's just say, for the benefit of this conversation, I would acknowledge and say that, okay, you're right. What I guess I struggle with, and perhaps this is even part of the conversation around how the debate is shaped, is that how would we in any way, shape, or form justify, let's say, you know, nuclear waste or, you know, radioactivity or the amount of obvious destruction that, you know, clear-cutting force, et cetera. Do we need to believe that is leading to our imminent destruction for that to seem illogical? And is part of the reason why these things can happen in people's minds, let's say, separate from us, like, oh, that doesn't affect me, because there should be more focus, and I'm asking you and I'm asking your peers, should there be more focus on talking about the interconnectedness of everything so that people, not us probably, but generations going forward might understand that regardless of whether this is going to lead to my imminent death, killing off a species is definitely affecting me in a negative way, or clear cutting forests in the Amazon is affecting me because everything here is part of the same system, the same network, etc. Is that something that scientists don't want to go, you know, because that seems a bit pseudoscience? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, not at all. I think that, first of all, Canada, the hell with the Amazon. Canada is a really good place to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
It's interestingly, three non-U.S. countries that I've always enjoyed visiting, I used to work for the Canadian Defense Research Board, were great countries showing the way in the world when Lester Pearson was Prime Minister of Canada and so on. Now Canada, Australia, New Zealand all have idiots for prime ministers. Your scientific community has taken to the streets because the attitude on science in Canada is so bad. Western Canada is being destroyed to get really crappy oil that should not ever be burned again because all scientists know we've got to stop burning it. And yet the biodiversity in Western Canada is going directly from the wrecking of large areas through the tar sands operations. And, of course, burning that is going to speed climate change, which is one of the huge things that's knocking out the parts of our life support system. So you don't even have to look beyond the borders of Canada. Your scientists have been the bravest in the world in coming out, actually taking to the streets and saying this has got to stop. So I'm still a great fan of Canadians. I'm just not a great fan of the Canadian government at the moment.
Yeah, and then there's a long line, I think, there, and getting longer. Obviously this speaks to what we were talking about before. When policy is affected by politics, then agendas being driven forward are going to be one, as we know, they're going to be one in the media. I mean, this is the world we live in now. And real platforms based around real things are very difficult to get through if they're difficult, let's say, to understand. You mentioned some programs about ecologists getting better at communicating things like climate change. But would you be an advocate, and, you know, is there any movement towards this in your community to make it an entry-level course for anybody that takes the sciences going forward, whether that be biology, chemistry, astrophysics, whatever it is, that they are the part of the entire graduate program includes communications courses? Is that something you'd get behind?
Oh, not only get behind, we pushed it very hard. One of the really disgusting things in the world today is you talk about, if you look at, for instance, the 15 idiots that are now running for the Republican presidential nomination, none of them show the slightest sign of understanding science. Why is that? Because science education in American schools is truly crappy. We put very little effort into it compared to what it should be. If you look at the great universities of the world, I happen to teach at the greatest university in the world called Stanford University in California. It's called that's why they call Harvard the Stanford of the East. The university has not made any significant change in its teaching, a real significant change, even though most of the science faculty understand that our civilization is threatened with an existential threat. In other words, universities are extraordinarily conservative. You think the church is conservative? Not at all. If the latest pope is way ahead of any university I know in what he's been saying, at least on the climate change and environmental side. So you're exactly right. Scientists should be trained to communicate. But beyond that, everybody who has a high school education should understand climate change enough to know that somebody like Senator Imhoff or I can never remember that. Oh, Rush Limbaugh, those other intellectual giants that we have to be told about all the time. Anybody with a high school education that was any good would know that Rush Limbaugh's head is wedged very thoroughly where he needs a plastic plate in his lower abdomen to see where he's going.
Yes, well, well said. And on that note, we'll take a break. We're going to continue on the other side. Talk about a book that's coming up on its 50th anniversary in 2018. Get into a bit of that as well with Dr. Paul Ehrlich on the other side of the break. It is What in the World? SiriusXM Canada Talks, Channel 167.
Here's Richard Garner with What in the World on Canada Talks, SiriusXM 167.
Welcome back to the show. Our guest is Dr. Paul Ehrlich of Stanford University. Leads a study recently that shakes the foundation, certainly of social media. And I guess before we get into the population bomb, I want to ask you about that. Are you encouraged by, because perhaps the reason why this maybe got a bigger reaction at the mainstream level, because there's a lot of chicken and the egg now that goes on in this new world we live in, where a story might actually pass by the assignment desks of mainstream news outfits, but if it ends up getting a lot of play, a lot of hits, a lot of views, etc., a lot of shares in social media, then it ends up coming around the back door and becomes something they need to focus on more, and in this case, that's kind of what happened. Are you encouraged by this new sort of democratized world, and again, with plenty of flaws, I'll acknowledge that, of social media being able to potentially be the missing piece of the puzzle here?
I think potentially is the right word to use. I will be encouraged if it goes in the right direction. Sadly, of course, as you know, you can get on the social media, you probably find 100 websites that say the Confederate flag was just for states' rights and had nothing to do with race and so on. You know, you can find, when you look up anything in evolution, the first sites that come up on social media are creationist sites. So it's a mixed bag, but I think we've seen in the past that human societies can change very rapidly when the time is ripe. And I think that the social media, in a case like this, can help ripen the time, which is what we desperately need. We need a, you know, who knows? I may be dead wrong. I may be a paid agent of the condom industry. We need to get people educated, talking, discussing, and so on. And certainly the social media helps with that, even though a lot of it's nonsense. So in my view, but of course not in the view of the people expressing their ideas.
Yeah, still early stages. But, there have been some things that I've been greatly encouraged at that, you know, certainly at the corporate level where companies have been almost shamed into changing some things. Again, tip of the iceberg stuff. But, again, only time will tell. Speaking of that, in 1968, you wrote a book called The Population Bomb. And that was, a major bestseller that is still talked about today. And although the issue of let's say, overpopulation doesn't get talked about as much maybe as it did a few years back, it's still, you know, when you're projecting outwards, I think by whatever it is, 2020, we're looking at, you know, some asinine amount, maybe 12 billion people on the planet or whatever it is. But one of the things I wanted to ask you, and again, I come at this from a bit of a different perspective, because I would agree that 12 billion people or 20 billion people on this planet going at the rate that we're going is unsustainable. And certainly we can see, you know, kind of where that movie ends. But my feeling has been that, and again, I'm not saying this would be easy, because obviously if you're India and China and you're just sort of getting started, so to speak, you're not going to be listening to other people say, look, you know what? Turns out we really messed things up over the last 150 years. So you guys are going to have to really slow your progress because the planet's already at this particular level. You're not going to get a lot of people that say, oh, yeah, for sure. But is perhaps the argument long term not necessarily how many people are going to be on this planet, but how we live on this planet?
Well, they're basically two sides of the same coin. In other words, we have 7.3 billion people today. When the population bomb was written, we had 3.5 billion.
Wow.
Half as many. And it's a combination of two things: how many people you have and what their lifestyle is, because you're the number of people you have is multiplied in terms of environmental damage by how much each one consumes and what kind of technologies they use to do the consuming. When we wrote the population bomb, Ann and I actually wrote it together, there were 3.5 billion people, and maybe a billion of them were living in misery. And we were told repeatedly not to worry, that we can easily give wonderful lives, great diets, so on and so forth, to 4 or 5 billion people. It's not going to be a problem. So we got to 5 billion people, and it was still a problem. And then now we're at 7.3 billion people. Roughly 800 million are starving each year. something on the order of 2 billion are micronutrient malnourished to the point where they can't function properly. And we're facing an additional 2.5 billion people in the next 35 years. 2.5 billion people is 500 million more people than there were on the planet when I was born in 1932. So you ask yourself the question, and we've actually just been working on got a paper in press on this. What are the chances of avoiding massive starvation when you add 2.5 billion people to a planet where the threat of climate change to agriculture is colossal, where the threat of losing species and ecosystem services is colossal to agriculture, where agriculture itself puts about a third of the agriculture and the food system puts about a third of the greenhouse gases into the atmosphere that's changing the climate, that's threatening agriculture, it's a very, very grim picture. I don't doubt, you know, when you do estimates, it looks like most people think that when you look at it, the planet in the long term with foreseeable technologies could reasonably support 2 or 3 billion people with a reasonable lifestyle, including an adequate diet for everybody. So that means we're more well over 2 times the number of people that could be supported if we really made a huge effort to have a sustainable society. The estimates usually are that to support today's population at the style to which you and I live would require a couple more Earths. And we don't see where the hell they're coming from.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that sort of segues, though, potentially to another conversation. And I'm curious at this point of your life and studying, again, societies and civilizations and demographics and human behavior at a macro level. Have we had enough of a sample size at this point of capitalism to say that it didn't work?
Well, the one thing we can say for sure is that capitalism in its present form is not working at many, many different levels. For example, the trickle-down theory, you know, that all you have to do is make the 0.5% in the United States and Canada incredibly more wealthy, that will give wonderful lives to the average Canadian and American, just doesn't work. So the the capitalist system in that sense doesn't work. It, by the way, would not have not worked in the sense of the hero of capitalism, Adam Smith, who wrote The Wealth of Nations, which idiot economists are always quoting to you about the invisible hand and so on. They don't know enough to have read his first book called A Theory of Moral Sentiments, which said a capitalist system basically could work if it was in a moral society. And moral societies don't take the food out of starving babies and give it to the Donald Trumps of the world. So the capitalist system hasn't worked. It's given a lot of people a wonderful life, but it hasn't worked for most people on the planet and isn't working. In terms of the environment, it can't work as long as it has the idea that things can grow forever. Perpetual growth is the creed of the cancer cell. And the idea that every possible problem can be solved by economic growth is just nuts. And you can see this in the crazy conversations over Greece and so on. The problem in places like Greece is not one of getting more growth, which will simply more wreck our life support systems. It's redistributing the wealth. And when you talk about redistribution, you're all of a sudden, I think, a communist term used. The communist system didn't work either. It was a perpetual growth system. None of the systems we've tried so far are adequate for the world of 2015. They weren't even adequate for the world of 1950, but we didn't realize it. And so one of the huge jobs for economics is to figure out a way to redesign an economic system so that, for example, the banking system, it doesn't depend entirely on continued growth. You know, the way we generate our currency is based on continual, perpetual growth. So it's a stupid model that doesn't work except for a very few people, and those very few people own TV networks and papers and so on and so forth, and convince everybody that more growth is needed. Even smart economists, like, you look at people like Krugman, who are pretty bright people, still see growth as a solution to everything. There are some wonderful exceptions in economics, like Partha Dasgupta, who was the head of the European Economic and the British Economics Association, Ken Arrow, colleague of mine, who got a Nobel Prize in economics, the first one, I think. There's some very bright people who know better, but they're not getting through, and the really great economists are not running the world. The people who are running the world are the moron economists who work for journals like the Wall Street Journal or the Australian, you know, things from the Murdochocracy. One single idiot.
I've often imagined a scenario where, like, let's say somebody lands here from Pluto or wherever one day in the future, and, you know, they're like, so why take me around, give me a tour, you know, and sort of give me the lowdown on this place here, and, you know, what kind of system you guys run here. And it'd be like, well, you know, we run something we call, like, I guess it's kind of a capitalist democracy, seems to be the dominant system that we run economically and politically. And, oh, really? That sounds super interesting. What is that exactly? Well, it's the pursuit of unlimited wealth and growth on a planet with limited resources. and you know, this person probably wanting to be polite would be, you know, I got some bad news for you, man. Like, that's 2 + 2 = 5. Like, I don't know if you guys really done the math on that. Clearly, that's not sustainable. And it is that simple, yet it somehow, some way, you get pushed to the children's table if you're making that point, because really the adults got it figured out. We're going to take a break on the other side. We're going to come back with our last segment with Dr. Paul Ehrlich on What in the World, Sirius XM Canada Talks, channel 167.
Everything to you. You say you want to start something new, and it's breaking my heart, Jolie. I must have dreamed a thousand dreams.
Welcome back to What in the World with Richard Garner on Canada Talks, Sirius XM 167.
And before we get into the sort of final points of our discussion today with Dr. Paul Ehrlich of Stanford University, first of all, thanks for taking the time. Because as we were talking about earlier, these are conversations that do require context, more than a two-minute story on the news. And, you know, this is what we try to provide here with a platform like this. And then we push it out as, you know, through as many platforms as we can. And, you know, if somebody can listen to this as a podcast, let's say on the subway or going to work or whatever it is, and understand a little more of the complexity, but a little more of the data that's out there, I think we got a little bit better chance than having this debated again through talking heads on Fox News. But we'll get to that again in a second. Before we finish up, where's the best place to find the work that you're doing, the books that you've written, and so people can stay tapped into, you know, what's coming out, the most recent, the most current stuff?
Better than that, they can get involved in developing and changing the discussion. They should go to the MAHB website, and it's MAHB. And the website is mahb.stanford.edu, mahb.stanford.edu. The MAHB was originally formed when there was a ecosystem service study done in around 2000, a millennium assessment of the state of ecosystems by about 2,000 scientists. And it didn't tell us anything we didn't know before, that the systems that support us are deteriorating increasingly rapidly. And Ann and I said, what we really need is a millennium assessment of human behavior. And that's basically where the MAHB came from, Millennium Assessment Human Behavior. So it's mahb.stanford.edu. There's a library, there's a blog, there's a series of conversations, and you can join. It costs nothing but about 3 minutes of your time, and you can get involved in the conversation. The whole idea is to try and get civil society. There are lots of people who are worried about the state of the world, about racism, about sexism, about overall stupidity, about the environment, about nuclear war, and so on. And the whole idea of the MAHB is to get people focused on the really fundamental things while they deal with those other things. But if you're not focused on things like growth of the population, overconsumption, inequity at all kinds of levels that hurt our battles to save the environment and save ourselves and so on, we're trying to get a focus so we'll get some political clout. Don't think it'll work, but it's worth trying, and it's a place you can get all kinds of information, all kinds of ideas, and contribute your own.
Beautiful. And we got, probably about 5 minutes left, so I'll try to be as, lacking in convoluted questioning as I can be here, but stay with me on this because it is a bit of a long arc here. I look back at my own personal growth, and there certainly was a time where I might have considered myself an atheist. I'm not 100% sure if that's true, but certainly the development of any critical thinker through their teenage years and whatever into your university years will usually cross paths with a complete and utter rejection of organized religion. That's a pretty easy thing to spot early on. And not, you know, no offense to anybody out there, but what I'm saying is that it doesn't take tons of education and sort of eye-opening information to start to see through the cracks of that thin veneer. But what I also find is that as I personally evolved, and I'm 46 years old now, that path can take you through the rejection of organized religion, but, you know, in the sort of throw the baby out with the bathwater, any type of sort of spirituality gets lumped in with that. And with a lot of my friends, a lot of my, you know, really smart, academic, intelligent, mostly liberal friends, that stayed with them their entire lives. This complete and utter rejection of everything else other than, you know, everything was random and we banged into each other. And it seems that there's, with quantum physics and other things these days, where there's potentially this idea of a unified field that sort of permeates everything, might be something like consciousness, whatever it is. All I'm saying is this. Personally, I'm much more open to the idea of that there's more beyond you know, the straight up matter argument. And I'm wondering, when that got subtracted, when any sort of, let's say, spiritual element of that everything's one, connected, whatever you want to call it, got subtracted from society, and again, I'm not talking about Jesus Christ or organized religion. I'm talking about a feeling of, like I said, connection with nature, with wildlife, with the planets, with everything else. It seems to me that that subtraction might have made it easier to get to where we are today on the negative side. This idea that I'm completely separate from everything, nothing affects me, poverty on the other side of the world doesn't affect me. I'm this one individual, and I'm here to make as much as I can and screw everybody else. I'm wondering if people like yourself or other people would come back to something that there is this broader thing out there.
You're right on track with a lot of scientists. I think, like most scientists, I believe in living in an evidence-based world. I also believe, as I have written, and I think most of my colleagues agree, that we need a quasi-religious attitude towards nature as one of the major things to trying to save biodiversity. Science doesn't give you the answer to everything. We are interesting cultural animals. Science doesn't tell you whether it's right or wrong to eat meat. As human beings, we've evolved to think about those things, come up with cultural things that give us answers. And very often we find a spiritual approach we think would be valuable. And again, specifically in the biodiversity issue, there's a huge debate among scientists about whether you should try and protect biodiversity only on the basis that is critical to running our life support systems, or whether you should try and do it on the basis that other organisms are our only living relatives that we know of in the entire universe, and that we should value them just because of that. And there's no scientific answer to that. I believe we should use both approaches, and I believe in both approaches. They're critical to us because the other organisms of the planet support our lives, and they're critical to us because we have an ethical or moral commitment as human beings to save the other living things in the universe. So, yes, I don't think you should not subtract the spiritual from your approach to nature. You also shouldn't believe crazy stories about supernatural monsters who created a universe with 300 sextillion stars. That's more stars than there are grains of sand on Earth's beaches, and believe that that monster still retains a deep interest in your personal sex life. You're in trouble.
Yeah, well said. Perfect way to say it. I think we got about a minute left. Are you, I don't want to get you into the prediction business, but, you know, are you optimistic? Are you pessimistic? And what do we absolutely have to focus on the most in the next 30 seconds?
Well, I'm very optimistic about what we could do if we change our ways and do the things that the scientific community has outlined in great detail, like stop burning fossil fuels. I'm very pessimistic about whether we'll do it. And all you have to do to see why I'm pessimistic is to follow the presidential race in the United States. That'll do it for you very well.
Or perhaps the run for the prime minister's office here in the fall.
I love Canada, and I've been all over Canada, and I worked in the Arctic and lived with the Inuit. And I hate to see what's happened in your government.
Yeah, well, you and me both. Thanks for taking the time today again. It's a real pleasure for us. We'll catch up with you down the line, and we'll push people to the site as well. And continued great work, and thanks for everything that you do.
Thank you for the exposure. I really enjoyed it. Maybe we'll talk later this fall when a couple of books are coming out.
Yeah, absolutely. Perfect. That is Dr. Paul Ehrlich from Stanford University. This is What in the World? SiriusXM Canada Talks, Channel 167.
The world is a place that will eat you alive in one day. Said the world is a place that you can't survive without faith.
Sometimes in my tears I drown, but I never let it get me down. So when negativity surrounds, I know.